What we're going to look at today is the biggest new feature in C# 8, which is a thing called nullable references. What gave me the idea to talk about this was actually some of the more advanced features of nullable references, but I decided, probably a bit unfair since it's such a new feature, to dive in with the advanced stuff. So I'm going to do this first video that just looks at the basic concept of nullable references and then move on to the more advanced features in another video. So if you're already familiar with the basics, you may want to skip this one and just wait till the more advanced one comes out in a few days' time. But for those of you who aren't familiar with nullable references, the immediate question you may be asking yourself is, well, haven't nullable references been there all the time in C#? Whatever reference we have, we can always put the value null into it. And that is absolutely right. What's really been introduced in C# 8 is actually non-nullable references, references into which we're not allowed to put the value null. And for that reason, there are actually quite a few backwards compatibility issues with nullable references or non-nullable references, depending which way you want to look at it. And that's caused a few problems in how they're integrated into C# 8. But we'll look at all of those. But before we look at the syntax, it's worth understanding the concept that we're trying to deal with. So if we take a quick look at this UML diagram, you'll see what I've got is three classes. I've got a motor car class, I've got a person class, and I've got an engine class. And we can see that a motor car consists of a person in the role of driver and also an engine. But what I've done is model those in slightly different ways. What we have with our driver is simply what's known as an association, whereas with the engine, we've got a composition. And there are various terms for that. We could say that the association simply means a motor car has a driver, whereas the composition means that a motor car contains an engine. Various different ways of talking about it in plain English. But in practical terms, what it basically means is a motor car may or may not have a driver, but a motor car always will have an engine. Now, before we worry too much about the details of that, it's worth bearing in mind that the validity of that modeling will actually depend on the type of system we're trying to implement. For example, if this were software for a car production line, then at certain stages in production, a motor car wouldn't have an engine, and then later on it would have an engine, and it'd probably never have a driver at all. So this wouldn't be the appropriate modeling for that. On the other hand, if this was software that was dealing with, say, a fleet of cars for a taxi company or a car hire company, then it probably would make sense in that your car always has an engine. Sometimes it has a driver, sometimes it doesn't. So let's just assume the modeling's correct, but bear in mind it will depend on the exact circumstances. So having said that's how we model it, the problem is we need a way of expressing that in C# so that the C# language can express this big conceptual difference between the association, which could be null, which is where we come back to our nullable references, and the composition, which we're saying definitely must not be null, a motor car must always have an engine. Now, if we look at that in C#, then what we'll see is we can do something like this. So here I've got an engine class, just one property of engine capacity, cubic centimeters, and then I've got a person class where we just have the name of the person, and then my motor car is made up of a couple of private fields, both references. We've got a driver and we've got an engine, and then we've got a constructor that takes both of those as parameters, sets them up, and then I've done a toString which prints out the driver's name and the engine's capacity. And in my program, I put all of that together. So I create a new motor car, give it a driver and an engine, and then write out the result. And if we just run that up, then we can see that Jensen drives a 1600cc car. That's all working perfectly well. But the problem is, that's not expressing our diagram. If you just look back at the diagram, remember, we're trying to say that a motor car may have a driver, but must have an engine. And at the moment, those are modeled in exactly the same way in the C#. And that means that we treat them in exactly the same way. Now, conceptually, we're saying that a car might or might not have a driver. And we haven't really catered for that here. If we were to not give the car a driver, so if I were to say change that to null and then run this, then we'll get an exception raised at the point where it tries to get the driver's name and the driver is null. So what we should, of course, do is put a safety check in for that. So we should do something like driver?name and then double?, and then maybe just put in something like no one. And so now when we run that, when we've got the null driver, it just says no one drives a 1600cc car. But we know, because we know that cars always have an engine, that we don't need to put a safety check on an engine because it's got to be there. So if we were to put the equivalent code on there and put some kind of default if it wasn't an engine, it would be completely unnecessary. But although we know that, the compiler and the language don't know that, and so it's still perfectly possible for us to pass in a null engine. And so now we'll get the same sort of error. We can see we've got a null reference exception. And it's worth emphasizing at this point, null reference exceptions and other related exceptions are what we can completely get rid of using nullable references. So the thing we want to do then is we want to indicate to the program itself that a engine cannot be null. And one way we might have done that is maybe with a new feature in the language. We could have, say, put an exclamation mark on there. You can see it's an error. This isn't how it does it. But it would have been an option to indicate that the engine, although it's a reference type, can never take on the value null. But they decided not to do that, really because the decision had already been made. Because quite a long time ago, 2008 release of Visual Studio, I think it was, we introduced the nullable value type, where I could say something like int question mark and then there's underscore sum val, and that would add to the range of possible values of an integer the additional fact that it could take on the value null. And so whereas an ordinary int couldn't take on null, we can now put that in there. So it was decided that it would make more sense in the long term, even though it's going to cause us problems in the short term, if we didn't have a way of indicating a non-nullable reference, but instead we used exactly the same syntax to indicate a nullable reference that we did to indicate a nullable value. So the way this works, this is the new language feature, we put a question mark after the type to indicate that it's a nullable reference. But you can see immediately we're getting a warning because it's saying that we've got to actually activate this feature. And this comes to the backwards compatibility issue, because with person question mark being a nullable reference, that's basically exactly what we used to have in C# 7 and earlier with simply a person. Whereas engine is the thing that's changed. That's now a non-nullable reference, even though it looks like a nullable reference in the older version. So this is where we're actually breaking the existing rules of C#, and we've got the backwards compatibility issue, and that's why it doesn't just happen straight off. We have to activate it. There's a couple of ways we can do that. One is, on a per file basis, you can simply, at the beginning of the file, do hash nullable enable. And you can see there's a few other options like disable and that sort of thing, but we're going to go for enable. And that means simply for this file, it's now going to understand the new features with these nullable reference types. And we can see now it's got rid of that warning. It now knows what we're talking about there. If you're trying to upgrade existing software that was written in C# 7 or earlier, you want to introduce nullable references, then this is probably the best way to do it, because it allows you to do it on a piecemeal basis, one file at a time. However, if you want to do it on a brand new project, you probably want it to be absolutely everywhere. And so we can do that in the project file. The odd thing is, it's still not been introduced as one of the options that we can actually see in the dialog that allows us to change project settings. So you'd expect it to be down here in advance, but there's nothing in there to say that we can have nullable. So what we actually have to do is dive into the XML and put it in there for ourselves. And so we go into the property group and we just add nullable enable, and that will now apply it to all the files within the project rather than just to the one individual one. And so if we just build that, go back into Motorcar, and we can see that it's now happy with that. So as I say, for a brand new project written purely in C# 8, I would just go for that straight off. What we can then see is if I, for example, remove that safety check that I put in on the driver. So now we are assuming that driver is never going to be null. It's now giving us a warning. And if we look at the warning, it says dereference of a possibly null reference. So because driver is nullable, it can have the value null. If the value were null, that would raise a null reference exception, and so it's giving us a warning about that. Notice also it gives us warnings for these things, and we can see here, if we're looking there, we've got a couple of examples. So it gives us a warning, and again, that's there deliberately to help with the backwards compatibility. Rather than making it an error, if you're applying this to existing code, which would break your program, it just makes it a warning. Again, certainly if I'm doing this in a pure C-sharp 8 environment, I would actually promote that warning code and various related ones to error codes, which you can do in your project settings file, just so that we don't skip over them. But I'll leave them as warnings for now, because we're going to clear them all away anyway. So we can see, though, that because driver is possibly null, and we're not checking, it's giving us warnings on that. Whereas on our engine, it's not giving us one, because we have specified that engine cannot be null. So we need to, in some way, just make sure we always test the driver. We could have done it like we did before, or if I did like this, if I just simply say if underscore driver does not equal null, and then just do else return no driver. Doesn't really matter how I do it. Simply the compiler can tell that it's been tested, and therefore, because we've tested it here, it can't be null there, and so that's perfectly okay. But actually, I prefer the way I had it before, so let's go back to that other one. And then just do question mark and no one. If we were to try and do something similar on the engine, you can see it still actually lets us do that, but that is completely redundant because engine can never be null. One other thing we've got to do is be consistent about this. So because we've made our driver field nullable, we also need to make sure that goes as nullable in the constructor there, just for consistency. And so now that's all working. Person is nullable in both places, engine is non-nullable in both places. And then if we go back to our program, we can obviously pass null in for our driver, and that will work fine. And if we run that up, we get the no one drives a 1600cc car. But if we were to try and pass null in for our engine, then we get a warning, and it's telling us that you can't convert a null literal into a non-nullable reference type. Basically, it's saying it's non-nullable, so you can't put that in there. Which means, because we can't put null in there, that's how it guarantees that engine will never be null here, and so we don't have to put the safety check in. So we'll set that back, and so we've got our engine there. You'll notice if we go to the error list, we've got one more warning there, but again, we should treat these like errors. And the problem we've got here is that on our person class, we've got this name property, and it's complaining that it's uninitialized. So what's happened here is we've got this property of type string, and string is a reference type, and therefore by default now it is a non-nullable reference type. It cannot take the value null, but because we haven't done anything in there, it's defaulted, the initial value is going to be null. So various ways we can get around that. We could just put in a value here, so have it set hello, but that doesn't make much sense to give it a value at that point. So the more normal way around it is to actually give it a constructor. So if we put a constructor in there and make the constructor take the string name, and then in here we could say name equals name. And in fact, having done it in the constructor, my instinct would be actually to remove that from the property. So now it's a read-only property. And so now we're guaranteeing that because that's the only constructor we have, we're never going to have a null value for our string. What it now means is back here, though, we can't use the member initializer. So here we have to go through the constructor. And so now that's going to work okay. So to summarize what we need to do, we need to activate these nullables because it's not backwards compatible. And then we need to start thinking everywhere in our code, whether in terms of our design, in logical terms, it makes sense for us to allow a null value into one of our variables. If it's something like a driver, in design terms, it's possible not to have a driver, so that can be null, so we put the question mark on there. If it's something like an engine, we've decided you've got to have an engine, so we don't put the question mark on there. And then once we've done that, the compiler will do most of the rest of the work for us. It will make sure that we never access a nullable reference without in some way first checking whether it's null, but it will allow us to do that on a non-nullable reference. And it will also check the consistency, so it would have been giving us warnings if we hadn't made that parameter nullable. So that's it. Really a pretty simple feature, just the use of a question mark in the appropriate place, and then the compiler does the work for us. The hard things to do are getting your design right, so actually deciding which of your reference types should be nullable and which of them shouldn't be, and then particularly if you're upgrading existing code, working through and making sure everything's consistent. But in the long run, it will reduce the number of null reference exceptions you get, and also in general simplify your code, because you won't be wasting any time putting safety checks on things like our engine.capacity. You'll only need to put safety checks on your nullable references where you know there's a possibility of them being null. There is more to it than that, so I will be showing you in the next video a little bit about some of the pitfalls with that. But for now, hope you find that helpful.